Well, it's lovely to be back in Athens. And I don't know, I imagine what you'd like to know is a little bit about what I'm going to do. I always said I wouldn't do another one-person play, because they're very lonely.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely.
But I've done three already, and one of them was the human voice here. But here I am, doing one. And it came about really because there was a lot of talk in England 3 or 4 years ago about dropping Shakespeare from the state school curriculum. So, you know, I thought it was vital that at school we learn Shakespeare because he's so relevant, he's so universal. And he's just the best. So I thought, well, this is my bit, really. I wanted to try and make him in some way accessible, more accessible. You know, people think 400 years ago. I just wanted to show people, you know, a lot of people are quite frightened of Shakespeare, or a lot of people in England anyway, maybe not so much abroad. I think, in fact, in Europe, you probably have a better knowledge of Shakespeare. I found that because I travelled to Hungary and Georgia and goodness knows where. And I think the Europeans probably are more familiar with Shakespeare than some of the British, many of the British. So that was my starting point. And then I knew that John Gielgud had done something called The Ages of Man. And I thought I'd do An Ages of Woman. And I wanted as much variety as I could, both in age, in kind, in character, in class, in all the different backgrounds. And so I just started to gather some of the women I liked, but I still didn't know what it was going to be about. And then I found that all the pieces that I was choosing were to do in some way with some kind of love. I mean, it's quite a broad brief. It's obviously romantic love with the younger ones particularly, but also family love and also love of abstract ideals like mercy or truth or power. So that's when I decided on the title, The Loves of Shakespeare's Women.
When I was a child, more than becoming invisible, more than having conversations with animals, more even than wanting to fly, I wanted to be able to get inside other people's heads.
I really like all the women in different ways. Sometimes I like them more to play than as characters, but they're all fascinating. I suppose probably my favorite character might be Beatrice. I love Beatrice in Much Ado About Nothing, but you know, I feel very tender, actually, about so many of them, the faulty ones as well. I suppose it's a bit hard to feel tender about Lady Macbeth, but or Margaret of Anjou.
Whiter than new snow on a raven's back. Come, gentle night. Come, loving black, proud night. Give me my Romeo. And when he shall die, take him and cut him out in little stars, and he will make the face of heaven so fine that all the world will be in love with night and pay no worship to the garish sun. Oh, I have bought the mansion of a love. hard to seem one. But I was one, my lord, with the first glance that ever... Pardon me. If I confess much, you will play the tyrant. I love you now. But not till now so much, but I might master it. Ah, if faith, I lie. My thoughts were like unbridled children, grown too headstrong for their mother. See, we fools, why have I blabbed? Who will be true to us when we are so unsecret to ourselves? But though I loved you well, I wooed you not. And yet, good faith, I wished myself a man, all that we women had men's privilege of speaking first. Sweet, bid me hold my tongue, for in this rapture I shall surely speak the thing I shall repent. Stop my mouth. My lord, I do beseech you, pardon me. It was not my purpose thus to beg a kiss. I am ashamed. Oh, heavens, what have I done? I have given suck. And know how tender it is to love the babe that milked me. I would, whilst it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from the boneless gums and dashed the brains out. Had I so sworn, as you have done to this, if we should fail, we fail. Screw your courage to the sticky point. And we'll not fail. As fond of grief, you say. As of my child. He speaks to me that never had a son. Grief fills the room up of my absent child. Lies in his bed, walks up and down with me, puts on his pretty looks, repeats his words, remembers me of all his gracious parts. Stuffs out his vacant garments with his form. Then have I reason to be fond of grief?